The following scholars to come to the dais. Professor X.P. Mauvo. Professor Mauvo, please come to the dais. Chachidananda Mishra. Dr. Nandini Mishra. Then Bharat Kumar, Professor Bharat Kumar. This symposium will be chaired by Professor Devika Saha, please come.
A very good noon to all of you. Now, the second session starts. Symposium that is on philosophical methodologies. There are three speakers. Professor X.P. Mao from Shillong. Dr. Nandini Mishra from Cuttack. And Dr. Bharat Kumar from Indore. Now, at the very outset, I must allot the timing. We are running late as usual. So, the speakers have been allotted 15 minutes. I hope they will follow the timing so that we could have our lunch in proper time. Thank you all. So, the proceedings begin. I am inviting Professor Mao to come here and present his paper.
Respected chairperson, Professor Saha, my co-speakers, my informal teacher, Professor Ramar Rao Papu, my real teacher, Professor S.R. Bhatt, Chairman ICPR, who is not here, delegates from India and abroad, many of our fellow delegates ask me from which country I come. And then I said, I am from India. But when I said, my name is Mao, then people think I must be the grandson of Mao Zedong, Chairman, Republic of China. But I told them, this is a sheer coincidence. Therefore, my request to all the learned delegates is that not to have that clouds of prejudice and biases because of that little political difference between India and China to my presentation. Philosophical methodology presupposes that one knows or one ought to know the history of philosophy right from the Greek time or from the Indian Vedic time or the Confucius or Lao Tzu's time to the present time, but for which, to be very frank, I am a novice. I'm more of a learner rather than thorough in the history of philosophy. Just as over the last 5 days, we have witnessed the different methods of people presenting their papers. So also in the philosophical methodology, there are a variety of methods, a variety of methodologies. And there is no method for others, for two reasons. For others, no clarity of thought. For others, there is ambiguity. And for others, clarity of thought is so much so that the problem of the question itself is so complex that a method becomes evasive. And thereby, even to have a method becomes impossible. Therefore, there are dialogical, they are analytical, they are aphoristic, and several others are there. But I will not dwell on those. Now, a small domain I would like to dwell, and that maybe I shall read out my paper, but I don't think I can read out even everything. The most important aspect of research method in philosophy is the proper and specific formulation of the question to which one seeks to answer by the research. And many a time, even the question is to be questioned in order to answer the question itself. The formulation of the question is to open up the topic of one's research. This is related to the logical structure of openness that characterizes consciousness of the researcher in philosophy. The emergence of the question is central to the situation of researcher in philosophy. The structure of the question is implicit in philosophical research. We cannot have research in philosophy without asking questions. Recognizing an object is different and not as the researcher first thought. Obviously, presupposes the question whether it was this or that, or whether it can be a completely presuppositionless inquiry or not any assumptions inquiry. From a logical point of view, the openness essential to philosophical research is precisely the openness of the thing under philosophical investigation. And even the so-called great philosopher or a great thinker is at times clouded by certain subtle and complex kind of prejudices. For instance, when I was at the University of Sydney in Australia, I asked Professor David Armstrong, what do you think of the status of Indian philosophy and Chinese philosophy? He said, they don't have rigorous and coherent and in-depth kind of thinking of philosophy and philosophization. They are more of words of wisdom and aphorism and mixed up with religion, etc. But further, when I interacted with other important Western philosophers, some of them took it very, very seriously and said even Indian philosophers had done very serious, rigorous philosophy. So, thereby, the point I wish to convey is that many a time, even in trying to formulate and follow the question, we have certain very, very subtle and complex layers of prejudices and biases and certain implicit assumptions in the name of trying to remove the assumption or even the presupposition itself. Therefore, now, being either this or that, the opening up of the thing for investigation had the structure of questioning. The logical form of the questioning involves knowing that one does not know the thing under investigation perfectly. And even perfectly here is in a relative sense. The essence of the question is, in its sense, the sense of the question involves a sense of direction from which the answer can be given. Questioning a thing places it in a particular perspective. When a question arises, it breaks open the being of the thing under investigation. The discourse that explicates this opened up being of the thing is an answer. The sense of the answer lies in the sense of the question itself. Contrary to the general opinion, it is more difficult to ask questions than to answer them. In order to be able to ask questions, the researcher must want to know, and that means knowing that he does not know. So, the researcher has to recognize the priority of the question in investigation. That actually reveals something of the thing under investigation. The research that is intended to reveal something of the thing under investigation requires that the thing be broken open by the question itself. For this reason, philosophical research proceeds by way of question and answer, or rather, the path of philosophical knowledge leads through the question to answer a question, mean to bring into the open. The openness of what is in question consists in the fact that the answer is not settled. It must still be underdetermined, awaiting a decisive answer, and that decisive answer may not even emerge, like Richard Rorty's conversational method or neo-pragmatic approach. The significance of questioning consists in revealing the questionability of what is questioned. It has to be brought into this state of indeterminacy, so that there is an equilibrium between pro and contra. The sense of every question is realized in passing through this state of indeterminacy, in which it becomes an open question. Every true question requires this openness, which Professor S.P. Gautam has very elusively pointed out this morning. It is basically no more than an apparent question. We have the example of apparent question in the pedagogical question, which are present in the question papers given to the students in the examination. This, the pedagogical question asked in the examination, is not an actual question at all, as it is question without a questioner. Similarly, the rhetorical question is also not an actual question, as it is not only has no questioner, but also no thing is questioned. The openness of a question is not boundless. It is limited by the horizon of the question. A question that lacks this horizon is, so to speak, floating. It becomes a question only when its fluid indeterminacy is concretized in a specific this or that. In other words, the question has to be posed. Posing a question implies openness, but also limitation. It implies the explicit establishing of the presupposition and further implication, in terms of which can be seen what still remains open. Hence, a question can be asked rightly or wrongly according as it reaches into the sphere of the truly open or fails to do so. A question has been put wrongly when it does not reach the state of openness, but precludes reaching it by retaining false presuppositions. It pretends to an openness and susceptibility to decision by researcher that it does not have, but if what is in question is not foregrounded or not correctly foregrounded from those presuppositions that are really held, then it is not brought into the open, and nothing can be decided by further investigation. The research question is expected not to be the slanted question. There can be no answer to a slanted question because it leads the researcher only apparently and not really or substantially to the open state of indeterminacy in which a decision can be made through research. The slanted question is not a senseless question, rather it is a question that is put wrongly because there is a question behind it. That is, there is an openness intended, but it does not lie in the direction in which the slanted question is pointing. The word slanted refers to something that has deviated from the right direction or right trajectory. The slant of a question consists in the fact that it does not give any real direction, and hence no answer to it is possible. Sense is always sense of some direction. For a possible question, correct sense, okay, thank you, must accord with the direction in which a question points. Insofar as research question remains open, it always includes both negative and positive judgment. This is the basis of the essential relation between question and knowledge, for it is the essence of knowledge not only to judge something correctly, but at the same time, for the same reason, to exclude what is wrong. Deciding the question is the path to knowledge. What decides a question is the preponderance of reason for the one and against the other possibility. But this is still not full knowledge. Even the so-called holistic science, to my mind, even this is not holistic in the sense we always approximate, and the so-called holistic keep receding. Therefore, the thing itself is known only when the counter instances are dissolved, only when the counter arguments are seen to be incorrect. Knowledge always means precisely considering opposite superiority of knowledge over preconceived opinion consists in the fact that it is able to conceive of possibilities as possibilities. Only a researcher who has questioned can gain knowledge, but questions include the antithesis of yes and no, of being like this and being like that. The priority of the questioning in the process of gaining knowledge shows how fundamentally the idea of method is limited for philosophical research. There is no such thing as method of learning to ask questions, of learning to see what is questionable. All questioning and desire to know presupposes a knowledge that one does not know. So much so, indeed, that a particular lack of knowledge leads to a particular question. But there is no method for a philosophical researcher for knowing himself that he does not know. There is a special difficulty for the researcher in knowing what he does not know. It is the power of opinion against which it is so hard to obtain an admission of ignorance. It is opinion that suppresses question. Opinion has a curious tendency to propagate itself. It would always like to be the general opinion, just as the word that Greeks have for opinion. Dosa also means the decision made by the majority in the council assembly. How then can ignorance be admitted and question arise? Question can occur to the researcher only in the way any idea occurs to him or to her. It is true that we do speak of idea occurring to us, maybe sometimes flashes of ideas or intuitive ideas. But we speak less in regard to questions that they occur to us, as we think that we raise them ourselves. But once the question emerges, we do say that answer occurs, or that the solution of problems occurs. What this linguistic fact shows is that there is no methodological way to arrive at the solution, but we also know that such ideas do not occur to us entirely unexpectedly. They always presuppose an orientation toward an area of openness from which the idea can occur. Right. Since my time is very short and the time has come, therefore, I could not do proper justice, but I have just opened up a little bit. So thank you. I do not wish to take others' time. Thank you very, very much.
Thank you, Professor Mao. In fact, I have nothing to do. My hands are all closed. There are two other scholars. I must do justice to them. So I am now inviting Professor Nandini to deliver her speech.
Good afternoon, everybody. Respected teachers on and before the dais, and my dear friends. I disturb you all because of my disability. But recently, I used to add two more legs, means artificial legs, because to protect my defective legs. Recently, it is not practiced. It will take 1 month time. Sorry to bear me. Okay. I have taken three trends of philosophical methodology, like analytical methodology, and hermeneutics deconstruction. Let me start my paper, because before the time limits, I should finish. Before the bell, I'll finish. Thank you. It is obvious that the methods used for arriving at the philosophical knowledge come under the scope of philosophical methodology. Prior to Bacon, emphasizing on the method of induction and Descartes taking resort to skepticism to arrive at certain knowledge, like that of science, the methods used by Greek thinkers were never treated to be significant. Aristotle once opined that human beings originally began philosophy because of wonder. Finding wonders to such wonders, very often armchair thinking or speculations were used by many who are well acknowledged as philosophers. However, the product of speculations or armchair thinking can never be taken as suitable methods in philosophy from rational standpoint. In this critical juncture, Bacon and Descartes tried to give definite directions to philosophy through the methods of empiricism and rationalism. Kant's attempt to emphasize on critical analysis seems to have paved the path in finding the importance of analysis in philosophy. A significant change was introduced to philosophy by the logical positivists with the recommendation of verifiability theory of meaning. And following it, philosophical problems were treated to be conceptual by nature. Obviously, the methods of conceptual analysis has been treated as the proper method of philosophy. Looking from the historical perspective, the methods followed by the pragmatists and existentialists were found to be a departure from the usual method followed during the period. The positivistic and analytic trends are treated to be modern period's methods of philosophy. It is seen that losing interest in positivistic, linguistic, and ordinary language, philosophy has made room for hermeneutics, semiotics, critical and dialectical theory, structuralism, post-structuralism, deconstruction, and postmodernism. Now I come to analytical methodology. The method of analysis cannot be separated from doing philosophy. Method of philosophization and analysis are almost synonymous. It happens to be the primary method of philosophy. In philosophy, to the question starting with what, why, and how, responded with several answers. The merit of the answer is usually established through the method of analysis of the concept involved in the questions. This method was in operation less conspicuously prior to the 20th century analytic revolution initiated by Moore and Russell and followed by a number of leading philosophers like Wisdom, Quine, Grease, Wittgenstein, Strawson, etc. One would agree with this view of the early part of the 20th century that the fate of philosophy in the years to come has to face a revolutionary change in the front of philosophical inquiry, which would be out and out analytical, and philosophers would be engaged in finding solutions to philosophical problems through linguistic analysis. For this reason, the 20th century has been treated as the age of analysis. Russell's attempt to search for an ideal language or logically perfect language gave birth to the philosophy of logical atomism, and it was the pathfinder for Wittgenstein to proceed in that direction at his early stage. It is maintained that philosophy aims at logical clarification of thoughts. A philosopher can help us in this important matter by showing us whether these utterances express genuine propositions, and if so, how they are to be analyzed. Wittgenstein, in his latter part, though attacked logical atomism, picture theory of meaning, etc., but did not deviate from the view that the method of philosophy is linguistic analysis. For him, philosophy is therapeutic, and the philosopher is to remove the puzzlement by removing the misconception about language. He has said, philosophical problems arise when language goes on a holiday. It is wisdom who has said that though philosophy involves linguistic clarification, but it is not enough. He considered that along with the linguistic therapy, psychological therapy is also required in order to go to the root of the problems. It is seen that the Oxford group of analysts have worked upon the view of the latter position of Wittgenstein and have built up what is known as ordinary language philosophy. Now, harmonetics. If the harmonetic movement can be thought of having several phases, then the Martin Heidegger's approach would be treated as the beginning phase, which is rich in philosophical harmonetics. The most important phase would be the contribution of Gadamer, Ricoeur, and Habermas. Palmer has mentioned six major features of harmonetics in the following manner: the theory of biblical exegesis, general philological methodology, the science of linguistic understanding, the methodological foundation of gestures of an phenomenology of existence and existential understanding, the systems of interpretation, both recollective and iconoclastic, used by man to reach the meaning behind the myths and symbols. Out of this, Roy brings out two primary intentions of hermeneutics as first, to ascertain the exact meaning of a text, sentence, or words. Secondly, to disclose and interpret the messages and significations content in symbolic form. So far as the ongoing march of hermeneutic is concerned, we find it to be embracing many formulations like methodological, ontological, dialogical, dialectical, descriptive, evaluative, prescriptive, reconstructive, etc. For example, the difference between hermeneutic of Gadamer and Habermas has been treated as the difference between dialogical and dialectical hermeneutics. Next, last one is deconstruction. Jacques Derrida, mostly been taught in United States, started his career in France, adopted new methodology, which is known as deconstruction. At first, Derrida offered a deconstructive reading of Plato, and it was followed by the rereading of Descartes, Kant, Hegel, Freud, Husserl, etc. According to him, no text is stable and completely circumscribed by its predetermined standpoint. Deconstruction is an approach to reading a text that grows out of a contemporary epoch of post-metaphysical thinking. It is concerned with posing the problem of the status of the discourse that borrows from a heritage the resources necessary for the deconstruction of that heritage itself. Derrida is concerned to radicalize a discourse and movement which has certain heritage of the age. Deconstruction is concerned with offering an account of the contention of a text and not through finding its meaning or the component parts, but making of its relation to explicit formulation undermine its implicit and non-explicit aspects. Here, the task becomes to point out that the text excludes by exposing what the text includes. The important aim is to highlight how remains undecidability in a text. Richard Doty explained it in the manner that in case of deconstruction, the accidental features of a text can be seen as betraying or subverting its essential message. It is seen that sometimes the method of deconstruction is confused with the reader's response theory. In the latter theory, a text understanding is produced through the reader's process of encouraging it. It is more important to point out that deconstruction does not aim at showing the text to be meaningless. Rather, it tries to show if they are overflowing with multiple or conflicting meanings. Here it is said, it is not claimed that the concept have no boundaries, rather there is scope to surpass it in different ways. The emphasis on the proliferation of the meaning in the process of deconstruction is related to the concept of iterability. The insertion of text into new context continually produces the new meaning that happens to be partly similar and partly different from the previous understanding. This is how there is a nested opposition between them. Thus, the so-appeared conceptual opposition can be reinterpreted as a form of nested opposition. Now, I'll just skip something, then I'm coming to my epilogue. To find a comparison between hermeneutics and deconstruction, I would like to agree with Roy, who writes, unlike the deconstruction who hammer on undecidability, the hermeneuticians emphasize on productivity and inexhaustibility. But if it is asked to choose anyone out of the two as better one, it should be both arbitrary and unphilosophical. The scope of philosophy cannot and should not be restricted to any particular method. At the same time, it may be pointed out that the journey of philosophy cannot proceed without the method of analysis, whether it is conceptual or linguistic whatsoever. Because this method is a generalized method of philosophy, one may opt for a specialized methodology, but it has to be followed along with the generalized method, that is analysis. Thank you. Thank you all for your kind attention. I'm thankful to all the members of Holistic Research Center for giving a wonderful service. Again, I would like to convey my regards to Professor Bhatt sir and Paneerselvam sir, who giving this opportunity. Thank you, sir. Thank you all.
Thank you, madam, for completing it within time. In fact, as you know, this is the most unpleasant task that I have been offered. So no way, there is still another speaker. So without talking anything, I am inviting Dr. Bharat Kumar to present his paper.
Respected Chair, my teacher, Professor Pradhan, and other esteemed scholars. Actually, I have a limited point, particularly after yesterday's general presidential address, Professor Tiwari dealt with regard to the method of philosophizing, I mean philosophical methodology and the nature of philosophy, and today's professor Gautam has dealt it in an exhaustive manner, and my co-speakers have comprehensively, Professor Mavon, Professor Mishra, have covered the the discourse regarding methodology. So basically I have in mind, when I say philosophy in India or Indian philosophy, I have in mind political philosophy in India, because I am trained in political philosophy. I'll straight away come to the point what I would like to really put forth before the audience for deliberation. Indian political philosophy has to get rid of alien concepts and categories and forms of thinking which are basically derivative in nature, drawn from Western theories or from the essentializing or totalizing ideologies generated in our land. What I mean to say is that we have to turn away from these discourses that are experience distant, that are constituted by experience distant concepts and theories. I mean to say that everything that matters in lived political experience, whether it's gender, caste, class, creed, race, have to be accounted for in our philosophies. So these abstract theories have to be looked at with some suspicion, either internally generated or externally imported. So our social and political philosophy are thought should articulate its concerns through native, vernacular, or indigenous, or experience-near concepts, as the present discourses do not seem to really reflect the ground situation as they seem to present themselves. So in this sense, there is a need to do a pratyahara, or a withdrawal, or a blinding procedure, or any bias reduction method of bracketing both Western political theory as well as our essentializing philosophies. And there is a need to retrieve and uncover indigenous conceptualizations, terms, categories of Indian social and political thought to find and follow and allow its logics and eventually be experimented with applying it normatively to theorizations of contemporary India's actual social and political realities. I'm not going to elaborate on the process of bracketing or epoch to this enlightened audience, but I'm just quickly, I sketch the method. Of course, pratyahara is a process of turning away from the data of sensuous intuition, conducting what phenomenologist Edmund Husserl would call it as epoch. So in order to engage what political philosophy was meant to do, where our mind still in conceptual silence, it would be obvious and practical to begin by looking at the lived experience, to go down, to turn to the persons who were supposed to have signed the social contract and whose lives are the ground for the polity's existence. So there is a need to interrogate the lumpen masses, the subalterns, the proletariat. In this respect, political philosophers must become auto-ethnographic anthropologists required for a grassroots bottom-up theory. It is the activity of being oneself, being at work, as Aristotle would call it. The discovery of oneself requires inwardness, turning away, and I was calling it pratyahara. I mean, unlike the sovereign agent position taken by Western ethnographers, Indian political theories are as auto-ethnographers and are subjects, ultimately subjected to the same fate as those we interrogate. We must listen to and not dominate our informants, as the authenticity of our theory really relies on in its grounding in Indian life worlds. Being subjects sharing the same fate, and being theories grounded in the realities of lived experiences, political theories have to be generated from first-hand lived experiences. I mean, there is a need to dig down into the lived experiences of the people who phenomenologically constitute the political reality where our concepts and categories will spring forth. So, in sum, what I would like to propose is there is a need to return to our own tradition, a tradition which is hybrid and evolving. There is a need to engage with contemporary I mean, there is a need to engage with the contemporary as such. Otherwise, I mean, a lot of discussion was there about relevance and topicality of philosophizing in India. So my point one is that there is a desperate need to engage with the contemporary and to involve in the process of deconceptualization. It's not just taking the concepts from Western world and then recontextualizing them or even reconceptualizing in relation in the same parameters and terms set by the Western theories, but there is a need to totally abandon the vocabulary, political philosophical vocabulary of the Western theories and involve and to turn to our native cultures in order to achieve autonomy or Swaraj in ideas, as KCB would call it. So, and also we have to engage our discourses in profound democratization, tied up with the agency of the governed to the lived experience of the masses. So in this sense, we have to be sensitive about the texture, logic, and materiality of thought, not getting merely carried away by the mere abstractions. Materiality of the thought, the location of the thought has to be really kept in mind. So in my reading, new philosophy, new theory can only emerge by resetting the essentials of Indian philosophical thought. So in synthesizing the reflective tools, we have to find or arrive with concepts, theories, and methods that are grounded. Grounded is a very important word. Grounded, ethically engaged in spirit, style, and content. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Bharat Kumar, for finishing your paper before time, I think. So, as a chairperson, I will just share some words and then conclude the session. In fact, you know, I must thank Professor Paneerselvam ji for selecting me as the chairperson. The papers that the three of the renowned scholars read in this session is about the methodologies. And in fact, though there are only three papers, they almost touched all the methodologies. Like in the very first, Professor Mao discusses about the questioning and the nature of philosophizing. And he beautifully illustrated some very important points rising from Rorty, pedagogical, rhetoric, so many things. As due to the paucity of time, it will not be possible for me to enter into that detail, but I must thank Professor Mao for enlightening us about this topic. And in the second one, Madam, she stressed all the three points like analytical hermeneutics and deconstruction. In fact, here I think Professor Paneerselvam ji is the master of these topics, but somehow or other, I have to teach all these things to my students. So in that way, I get also enlightened after hearing Professor Nandini's paper. And lastly, Dr. Bharat Kumar enlightened us about the phenomenological methodology. In fact, this is the area which I used to teach in my university. So whatever it is, I must thank all the speakers that they have cooperated within this scheduled time, and I must thank the audience for their patient hearing. Thank you all.
Thank you so much for the chairperson as well as scholars who have presented papers. Now we have the honor of felicitating our chairperson as well as the speakers. Sri Anil Bhai would honor our chairperson, Professor Devi Asaha, with a bouquet. Now, Professor Nandidaji will be honored by Anil Bhai. Dr. Bharat Kumar will be honored by Anil Bhai. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Anil Bhai. And I thank once again our chairperson for conducting this session so nicely, and all the three speakers, Professor Mavo, Nandini Ji, and then Professor Bharat Kumar, for their excellent presentation. With this, we close this session. And 2 o'clock, we have parallel session, technical sessions.